We are in Triba, Monan Smith, Cornwall. It's 3rd of April 2012. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Dr. Mark Stelasiewicz from Polish Heritage Society. We came here today to talk to you about Arnhem. Could you please introduce yourself?
My name is Tony Hibbert. I was the brigade major, the first parachute brigade at Arnhem.
Can you tell us your age?
They tell me, 94.
Where did you grow up in the United Kingdom?
Oh, all over, but quite a lot of it in the New Forest.
What was your military rank at the time of Operation Market Garden?
A major.
Major. And your military rank at the end of your military career?
Major.
Major. When did you retire?
Major retired.
Major retired. When and where did you join the 1st British Airborne Division?
After the Battle of Dunkirk, I volunteered for the 2nd Airborne, 2nd Parachute Commando, and out of that commando, the Parachute Regiment was formed. And out of the parachute regiment, the 1st Parachute Brigade developed.
What attracted you to the 1st British Airborne Division?
Well, it was my baby.
That's good enough. How tough was the training?
I think by present-day standards, pretty easy going. I think they work very much harder now.
What did you believe was the 1st British Airborne Division mission? What have you been training for?
To win the war by Christmas, but specifically to take Arnhem Bridge and hold it for 24 hours until the troops from the south caught up with us.
And what did you think of 1st Airborne Division's situation at Arnhem at this time?
I mean, when I arrived there, I was about 6 miles away on a LZ, and it was a beautiful sunny day, just like today. Sun was shining, everything was peaceful, and very difficult to believe that there was a war, except that wherever we saw any of the Dutch troops as we were marching towards the bridge, they all came up and said, "Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye, Ktomi."
When did you meet Poles first time? And obviously, what did you think of 1st Polish Airborne Brigade at that time?
I was sent by the 1st Parachute Battalion to meet the Poles and to find out from them what they knew about parachuting, and I was amazed to find that they knew a hell of a lot more than we did, and we were very grateful to them for their help.
And how surprised you were to see Poles, they weren't sent to Arnhem.
We'd had Poles next door to us right back in 1940, in the Battle of Britain, where we had one of the squadrons right next door to us, and they were great heroes to us.
Can you comment on how prepared for this mission was 1st Polish Airborne Brigade? Were they battle ready?
Yes, they were. As far as we were concerned, they performed very well whenever they were dropped in the right place, which wasn't very often.
Can you tell us a little bit about a situation at the bridge when you've been holding it longer than down to last 100 soldiers and what happened?
Well, on the first day, we managed to get about 750 of our troops, 1st Parachute Brigade troops, onto the bridge, which included 350 of the brigade headquarters staff and the remaining 2nd Parachute Brigade, Battalion. And from that night of the 17th of September, from that night we were cut off and surrounded by the Germans from that moment. And we had, our job was to stay there for 24 hours.
How heavy was the fighting?
Initially, it was fierce. It was fierce because they brought their artillery units up south of the river, so they were shooting at us at about 500 yards. They were able to do a great deal of damage.
Can you tell us what were your official objectives at the bridge?
Objective was to capture the bridge and hold it for 48 hours until the troops from the south reached us.
Please describe what happened next. Did your unit achieve its objectives?
After the second day, the Germans started using phosphorus shells, and we had a large school building with a large cellar into which we put our wounded. And by certainly the fourth day, we had about 350 wounded, of which about 50 were Germans, in the cellar. And we had nearly all our men by this time deploying, pushing the flyers out. They weren't able to shoot back because we had to keep the flyers out.
How did the situation unfold after 48 hours at the Arnhem Bridge?
We were unable to hold on to the brigade headquarters after 72 hours because nearly all of it was alight. So we asked the Germans for a two-hour ceasefire, which they agreed to. And in fact, they sent some of their men to help get our wounded out of the cellar.
How did the situation unfold after 48 hours at the Arnhem Bridge?
By this time, there were only 100 of us able to fight. And we moved them to a vacant building about 500 yards from our old position. And we split the men up into 10, each under an officer. And and they had approximately 5 rounds of ammunition each. And we ordered them to work their way through the surrounding Germans, and there were a hell of a lot of them, and to make their way back to the divisional perimeter at Oosterbeek. Amazingly enough, the first batch went out, and two of those managed to get back to Oosterbeek by floating themselves into the water and being washed down as dead bodies. But unfortunately, they were killed when they got to the other end. And of all the other people, we were all at one stage or another taken prisoner.
What was the effect on morale?
It was something which the Paras didn't think would be not possible, but not acceptable, that no one would be prepared to surrender. But of course, we forgot that when you've got people who are wounded and... but we gave up in ones and twos. We never surrendered as a group. Bad for morale.
Please describe the final stages of the battle. How did the 1st Independent Polish Brigade perform at Arnhem and Riel?
I knew Brown Urquhart very well, and he was actually with the Poles at Riel, and he spoke very highly indeed of the Polish units surrounded, commanded at that stage by General Sosbowski. The only other information I had was of the Poles that dropped on one of the landing zones of the 156 battalion, and I understand they had considerable difficulty there because the Germans were holding the LZ, and the 156 battalion had just landed, and the Polish, I think they were anti-tank gunners, landed in the same area. But of course, they were speaking to each other in Polish, and the Germans were speaking to each other in German. And to the British on the other side of the thing, thought that the Poles were Germans. Mm. And so I'm afraid that there became a lot of the problems.
Crossing the River episode. What have you been told about the role of General Sosabowski at practical level?
General Sosabowski, up to his neck in water, holding onto the rope that they were using to pass the poles up to the north bank. And there was a great deal of firing and a large number of casualties.
Do you believe the brigade under General Sosabowski's command should have received the recognition from Britain?
Brown Urquhart and I only went back many years after the day, and we discovered that General Brigadier Sosabowski had been dismissed. We were shown by the Dutch Crown Prince two letters, which I considered to be quite disgraceful. And since that day, it has been my... Before I die, I said that I would make sure that dismissal was revoked, and that the Polish brigade should be honored in the same way that the British were.
Is the Dutch example recognizing Polish Brigade and General Sosabowski something to compare with?
A few years back, I and many of my friends were invited to Holland to a ceremony in The Hague at which the Sosabowski children were presented with a high honor for Sosabowski. After that, the colors of the Sosabowski Parachute Brigade were paraded three times around the huge assembly park, and then the Queen of the Netherlands presented the